Okay, let's go ahead and get started. Well, good afternoon and welcome back from space for those of you who got to take the journey. And thank you for attending this session, Exchange 2013, High Availability and Site Resilience. Just out of curiosity, how many of you are running Exchange 2010 today? And how many of you have database availability groups? All right, how many of you have DAGs extended to more than one site? All right. How many of you are running 2007 with CCR? Anybody using SCR? All right, anybody running 2003? Anything earlier than 2003? No? Okay, great. So in this session, the agenda is pretty straightforward. I'm going to walk you through some of the very significant and important innovations that we've made in Exchange 2013 in three specific areas. We're going to talk about the storage innovations that we've done, particularly with respect to some of the challenges that we have faced in deployments. We're going to talk about the high availability features and the innovations we've done in that space. And we're going to talk about the innovations that have made site resilience much more operationally simplified in Exchange 2013 as well. So let's pull the curtain back and start with talking about the storage innovations that we've made. Now, as we go through each of these sections, the way I'm going to frame the conversation is I'm going to first talk about the challenges that we addressed and then the innovations that we have to address those challenges. In the storage area in particular, when I talk about these challenges, I want to point out that all of these challenges and all of the innovations we have are specifically targeted towards JBOD environments. If you're not familiar with that acronym, JBOD, it stands for just a bunch of disks. It's basically running without RAID. So JBOD is not a new configuration, obviously. It's what we had before we had RAID. So we've moved away from the days of keeping copies at the storage level, and we've moved to application-based copies as a recommendation in Exchange. So because we've targeted JBOD, there are particular challenges that we've faced as a result of running in a JBOD environment with these low-cost, faster disks. So one of the challenges is that disk drives today, they are getting larger and larger and larger, but they're not getting any faster. So today you can get multi-terabyte drives. Perhaps by this time next year you'll be buying drives as large as 8 terabytes. And in fact, it's specifically 8 terabyte drives that we've optimized for, but we'll talk about that in a minute. Now, what I mean by capacity is increasing, but IOPS is not, the drives are not getting any faster. And in fact, you won't see disk drives get any faster in your lifetime. The laws of physics are simply preventing us from moving forward with storage technology using the manner in which we use it now. First of all, there's not enough power to even spin platters that fast. And second of all, even if we could come up with the power, we don't have any materials that can stay together when it's spun that fast. The other challenge is your database sizes have to be manageable. Now, our best practice recommendations for database sizes are if you're not replicating your databases, keep them no greater than 200 gigabytes. But if you are replicating your databases in a DAG, then you can safely grow them to 2 terabytes. And by safely, I don't mean in terms of the application. I mean in terms of your operational ability to manage those databases, to do things like reseed operations, et cetera, et cetera. And in terms of reseed operations, specifically in a JBOD environment, because you don't have RAID, every time a disk fails, that's going to be a database failure, and that's going to trigger failover, and that's going to result in the need to replace that disk and reseed so you have another healthy passive copy in its place. And then in terms of the passive copies, some of the challenges we have are around the passive copy IOPS. And in fact, the IOPS and the passive copies in Exchange 2010 are equal to the IOPS for the active copies. And we did a lot of work to reduce IOPS there to enable some of the features I'm going to be talking about today. Then with respect to lagged database copies, those types of passive copies that are delaying replay of the log files, they have some other particular challenges as well. So for one thing, they require manual care. Okay, and that means, for example, that in certain situations, low disk space scenarios, page patching conditions, threats to redundancy and so forth, an administrator has to intervene to take action to preserve that lag copy. And then, of course, on top of that, lag copies have what we call asymmetrical storage requirements. That means they require more storage than a regular passive or regular active copy because they are holding the log files in the file system for a much longer period. So the challenges that we have are addressed squarely by these innovations that we have in Exchange 2013. That would be a feature called multiple databases per volume, for example, or a feature that we have called auto reseed, or our ability to automatically recover from most storage failures, or the lag copy's new abilities to sort of care for themselves in certain situations. So let's talk about the first feature, multiple databases per volume. Now, as I said earlier, all of the storage innovations are largely targeted towards JBOD environments, but they're fully supported in any storage configuration that is supported by Exchange. So if you're using RAID, if you're using a SAN, if you're using DAS, any supported storage that is supported by Exchange, you can use any of these features with, even though they are designed primarily for JBOD environments. So one of those features is multiple databases per volume. And this has to do with the first challenge that I talked about, the fact that disks are getting bigger, but they're not getting faster. And remember, about this time next year, if you're deploying a new implementation of Exchange, the cheapest and best drive you'll be able to buy is going to be an 8-terabyte SATA or SAS disk. That is what we specifically optimized Exchange for. But now you've got this competing challenge, okay? So let me show you what I mean by multiple databases per volume and how we solve that challenge. So multiple databases per volume is what it sounds like. Multiple databases on the same single disk volume. And those gray cylinders that you see there, that is one disk volume. That is one single JBOD disk that has been partitioned with one single volume. And on that disk are four databases in my example, each of which is in its own directory. So what is the problem that we're trying to solve with this? Well, the problem is this. Going back to what I said earlier about our recommended database sizes, if you buy an 8-terabyte drive and you keep your database sizes within our recommended size limits, well, that's going to be a 2-terabyte database set, and you'll effectively be wasting 6 terabytes of the storage that you purchased on every disk that you purchase. Okay? We don't like that in Exchange. Our whole purpose in Exchange is to make you be able to efficiently use all of the hardware that you purchased, whether it's memory, CPU, or storage. We want to use all the resources because, after all, that's why you bought them. So you might think, well, okay, I've got an 8-terabyte drive. I don't want to waste the space. So then I'll go ahead and I'll just grow the database larger than 2 terabytes. And there, now I got my hardware efficiency. But that in of itself creates its own challenges. So first let me describe the model, and then we'll walk through how we solve the challenges. So in this model, which, by the way, I want to point out is just one of many different examples, many different ways you can leverage this feature. It doesn't require 4 databases per volume. You can do this with 1, with 2, with 3, with any combination that you want. But in my configuration, what we have here is we've got a 4-member DAG, so we've got 4 servers there. We have 4 databases, DB1, 2, 3, and 4. And then on each database, we also have 4 copies. So here's the active copy of DB1, passive copy of DB1, another passive copy of DB1, and a lag copy for DB1. Now, my example uses a lag copy. A lag copy is not a requirement for this configuration. It's just showing that a lag copy is also supported and one of the many options you have available to you. And we also have 4 databases per volume, each one of these disk volumes, which again is just one 7500 RPM SATA or SAS disk. In this case, it could be 8 terabytes or maybe 2 terabytes, depending on the example I'll show you in a moment. But here we have 4 databases per volume. So we have a lot of symmetry in this DAG. We've got the same neighbors on all servers. We have the same number of database copies as we do databases per volume. We also have the same databases on each server as well. Everything is very nice and symmetrical. Okay? And that is one of the points of symmetry I want to point out, because that is one of our recommendations, is when you are leveraging this feature and the companion feature called auto reseed, which I'll talk about next, we do recommend that you have this form of symmetry where the number of database copies you have matches the number of databases per volume that you'll deploy. That's not a requirement, it's just a recommendation. So, going back to the challenge that we're trying to solve here, think of just a simple example where you've got 1 database on each of the volume. Okay, and again, this could be a 2-terabyte volume, could be an 8-terabyte volume. Let's just pretend for our purposes that it's an 8-terabyte volume here. Okay, so now what happens? It's a JBOD environment, which means, remember, every time we lose that disk, we're losing the database that's on that disk. Okay, but that's not a problem because that's how we've designed the system. The system will simply fail over and the database will become active on one of the surviving servers. But of course now, we have to do something here. We've got to replace the disk and we have to invoke a seeding operation. So in a single database copy per disk type of scenario, if that database is within our size limits, within 2 terabytes, that'll take you about 23 hours to do the reseeding operation. But if you ignore our size limits and you grow the database up to 8 terabytes and you fill up that disk because you want to use it all, guess what? It's going to take you 93 hours to do that reseed operation. Okay, so first of all, a couple things about that. One is that that's operationally untenable. If it's going to take you 93 hours to possibly restore redundancy for your database, that is a horrible place for you to be in. But secondly, you also have to consider the ability to reliably reseed 8 terabytes worth of data over the network. And remember, in reseeding, we cannot pick up where we left off. So if you're 6 terabytes into that seed operation and you have a network hiccup, you got to start from scratch. So that becomes a problem. So that problem and both of those problems are solved by this configuration, multiple databases per volume. Because in the same scenario, if you lose this database, or if you lose this disk rather, you've lost all of these databases, but now you're in a slightly different scenario. First of all, you're reseeding from multiple sources. So we're no longer source bound with the seed operation like we are when we're coming from a single database copy. It's all about the source. The source is always going to be the bottleneck in a seed operation. It's not going to be the network. It's not going to be the target. It's always going to be the source. But because we're no longer source bound and we're able to seed all of the data on this disk from multiple sources, we get faster aggregate seed time. Okay, how much faster? Well, if you're talking about a 2 terabyte disk, so that would presume these are 500 gigabyte databases, that'll take you about 9.7 hours to do the seed. But if this is an 8-terabyte disk with 2-terabyte databases, now you're only looking at about 39 hours to reseed that disk. So you're still reseeding 8 terabytes worth of data, but because it's chunked into multiple databases and coming from multiple sources, you get a much faster aggregate seed. And so now we've been able to solve both problems. You can still keep your databases within our minimum size guidelines, but at the same time, leverage these very large hard drives that some of you may be deploying on sometime next year. So the requirements are very simple. That one disk, it's just got to be formatted as a single partition. So no matter how big the disk is, it's just going to be one big volume all by itself. That's the only requirement. In terms of recommendations, as you saw in the example, we do recommend that you have the same neighbors on all servers, and we do recommend that the number of database copies equal the number of databases per volume that you'll deploy. Those are simple, some nice symmetry requirements, or recommendations rather, that give you a very good building block or brick type deployment possibilities. All right, let's talk about auto reseed. So what are the challenges there? Well, again, as you saw in the example, anytime that you lose a disk, it's taking out a database with it. Okay? So what that means is that you have to have very fast and reliable seeding operations. Now, as you might imagine, in a service as large as Office 365, where we have thousands and thousands and thousands of servers and thousands and thousands and thousands of databases on thousands and thousands and thousands of disks, that we experience a large amount of disk failures. It's simply because of the scale that we're at, we see a large number of disk failures. Now, historically, when a disk fails and takes out a database, we would have to dispatch an operator, which is what we call an administrator in the service. We would have to dispatch an operator to go out and replace the failed disk and then kick off the reseed operation and then babysit that operation and make sure it completed successfully. And every time we have to do that, that costs us money. Okay, and if we're trying to run a large-scale economical service at a very low cost to you, we got to keep our costs down as well. So we needed a mechanism whereby we didn't have to send an operator around. And that is, in fact, what auto-reseed is. Auto-reseed is the ability of the system to automatically reseed a disk that was initially provisioned as a spare disk, and it will grab that spare disk, map it, do the seeding operation, verify that it was healthy, and that eliminates the need to have the administrator do the heavy lifting, because at that point, all the admin has to do is pull out a dead disk and replace it with a good disk. So, how does it work? This is a very, very basic illustration here. Over here, we've got one server. We'll get to that in a minute. But in the middle, we've got this other server, and it has a couple storage pools. One is the pools of in-use storage. That's where we're actually hosting the databases. And the other is just a couple spares that have been put in the system as well. And the way it works is one of the in-use databases dies, or the disk dies and takes out the database with it, auto-reseed will automatically grab one of those spares and remap it through mount points into the system. And after it's been mounted, it will go ahead and initiate a reseed operation from whatever copy just became the active copy as a result of that failure. And it will automatically reseed that disk for you, and then, like I said, it's only up to the administrator to replace the failed disk. So the workflow is pretty simple for auto-reseed. It will periodically scan for databases that are in a failed and suspended state. And we'll try to push them out of that state by suspending and resuming first, but if that doesn't work and the database is actually in a failed and suspended state, that is the input that triggers the auto-reseed workflow. Now, if you have a configuration where you're using multiple databases per volume, then we require all of the all of the databases on that disk to also remain in a failed and suspended state. So if you've got four databases on there and three are failed and suspended and one is good, auto receive will not do anything because it's not a disk failure at that point. But assuming it is remaining in a failed and suspended state, then it'll go through some prerequisite checks, one of which is to obviously make sure that there's a spare drive available. Assuming all the prereq checks pass, then auto receive will automatically grab that spare drive and remap it through mount points, and I'll show you what that mount point structure looks like in a moment. After that, it'll initiate the seeding operation, and again, it will always and only seed from whatever copy just became the new active copy. And then once it's done with that, it will verify that the seed is completed, it is now healthy, and then like I said earlier, at that point, it's up to the administrator to go ahead and pull out the dead disk and replace it with a good one. All right, so how do you configure auto reseed? Well, you can take an existing DAG and you can sort of retrofit auto reseed into it, but that's difficult because it's going to require downtime and there's a lot of moving parts that you have to move around and all the structure that you have to create. But if you instead configure your DAG with auto reseed in mind, then it becomes much easier. So here's how you would do that. First, you would configure the storage subsystem, which would be those in-use volumes and those spare disks. Then you would create the DAG and take the servers that have those storage that you configured and add them to the DAG. And then at that point, you would create the directory and mount point structure that I'll show you in a moment. Then at that point, you would go ahead and configure three new properties of the DAG that are needed for auto reseed. And then just like you would with any DAG, you'll create your mailbox databases and your mailbox database copies. So let me show you what the configuration looks like. I don't mind saying it is quite detailed. The other thing I would also point out is there is only one supported configuration. You have to actually configure auto reseed the way we have hard-coded things or it will not work. So what you're seeing up here, you see that circle with a little slash in it. That is the root of my volume. Remember I said things have to be configured as a single volume. So that is the root of my volume. That's C colon backslash, if you will. Underneath that root, there are two folders, one called exchvols, the other called exchdbs. Now, those are shortened custom names I've used for my example. The default names are actually exchange volumes and exchange databases. So, under where exchange volumes would be, you see those three purple cylinders, volume 1 through 3. That's my storage. So, that's where I tell exchange through the autodag properties where my in-use volumes are located. So, volume 1, as you can see over here, has a database under it as well. Volume 2 has a database. Volume 3 is my spare drive. Now, over here under Exchange Databases, there are two yellow cylinders, one MDB1 and one MDB2. Those are my databases. So this is how I tell AutoDAG, or AutoReseed rather, where the databases are located. But you see this arrow right here going from here to here and here to here. That should tell you what we're actually doing. We're actually exploiting Windows Server's ability to create multiple mount points that point to the same location. So that's what we're doing here. This MDB1 that's under here, under this directory, is mounted the same way this is mounted under here. We've just taken the same place and mounted it under two different folders, if you will. So, under volume 1, you see that MDB1 there. And under MDB1, you see MDB1.db and MDB1.log. These are hard-coded paths. Now, the database name can be whatever you want, but whatever the name is, this has to be the database name. This folder name has to be the database name. This folder has to be database name.db. This folder has to be database name.log. Here's why. Auto reseed was created in the service, again, to save us costs. And in the service, we have only one way that we deploy things. We have a fixed configuration for our paths. So we hard-coded those paths into auto reseed, and then we decided to ship auto reseed on-premises so that you could benefit from it as well. But unfortunately, that means because the paths are hard-coded that you get to now adhere to our pathing standards if you're going to use auto reseed, which is a very small price to pay for the awesome functionality that you get out of this. So the three DAG properties, those are configured using set database availability group. One of them is the auto DAG volumes rip folders path. That points to that exchange volumes folder. So by default, that's what it'll be set to. If you're using the default paths, you don't need to configure that property. The other auto DAG databases root folder paths, that will point to C colon exchange databases. And again, if you're using that default path, you don't need to configure that. The last property is this auto DAG database copies per volume. And that's where you tell auto reseed how many database copies are in each disk. So it knows to check for multiple databases in a failed and suspended state if you're using that configuration. So in my example earlier, I would change that to a value of 4 because I had 4 databases on each volume. Okay. In terms of auto reseed, again, we do require you to have that single partition. We do require you to use that a hard-coded path as well. Again, as long as you follow the instructions, everything will work fine. And in fact, you can find the instructions at that URL. I wrote them personally. I've had them tested throughout the service. I've had them tested with storage partners, with TAP partners. I can assure you they are bulletproof, and I would invite you to grab them and try it out and prove me wrong. All right, let's talk about automatic recovery from storage failures. What does that mean? Well, the challenge here is that storage controllers are basically miniature PCs, and that means they can crash or they can hang, or other operator intervenable situations might occur. You might lose a bunch of vital system elements. You might have hung or highly latent I/O. You might have, like for instance, some event that requires an administrator to go out and hit the power button and reset the computer in order to recover from it. Again, we don't want to send a human out there to do that every single time that happens, particularly at the scale we're at. So we actually, in Exchange 2010, started the behavior of giving Exchange the ability to recover from some of these failures. So we had some features in Exchange 2010 to do that. We carried those forward into 2013. We introduced new features in Exchange 2013 RTM to do that, and we introduced even more in the upcoming cumulative update 1 for Exchange 2013. So here's what those behaviors are. So in 2010, we had a behavior called ESC database hung I/O. If we were not able to read from or write to an ESC database within, in this case, 240 seconds, Exchange would automatically correct that problem, recover from the problem by forcibly rebooting the box. What do I mean by that? I mean the replication service would terminate the winInit.exe process on the box, thereby causing a bug check or what we all know as a blue screen. So Exchange is borrowing this feature from Windows Server and Windows Failover Clustering, who have similar features to cause an intentional bug check of a box to recover from a problem that would normally require administrator intervention, somebody coming up and hitting the power button. Similarly, the failure item channel, that refers to the crimson channel area in the event log. We use that channel during normal operations. That's how Active Manager knows about things like store and storage and ESC problems. If we can't read to or write from that channel, that's a big problem for us. So if we have a 30-second window where we're locked out, we will recover from that by forcibly rebooting the box. And of course, when we do reboot one of those boxes, that triggers the normal server failover behavior, so it restores service without, again, requiring an administrator to intervene into the problem. The system disk heartbeat, we periodically send unbuffered I/O to the system disk, and we make sure that that's always there and responding. Obviously, if the system disk is not responding or it goes away for a certain amount of time, we have a big problem. So if that happens for more than 120 seconds, Exchange will self-recover by, again, forcibly rebooting the box. Now, those are the 2010 behaviors, and they're all in 2013. But 2013 has some new behaviors, like system bad state. This is where the system is in such a bad state that we can't schedule any threads. Even managed code threads can't be scheduled at that point. So, once again, Exchange self-recovers by terminating that process and bug checking the box. Long I/O times. Long, of course, is relative, but from an Exchange perspective, if we have I/O that comes out and doesn't come back within 41 seconds, that's a problem for us. We're going to go ahead and recover from, once again, forcibly rebooting the box. And the third one in blue under 2013, that, of course, isn't directly storage-related. It's when the replication service is consuming too much memory. Too much, in this case, is more than 4 gigabytes. So what we'll do first is we'll restart the replication service when we encounter that condition. It should never, ever need more than 4 gigabytes. But if it starts growing its working set beyond that, we will restart it and automatically recover from that. And then if it happens to continue to grow past 4 gigabytes after that again, then we'll recover by, once again, forcibly rebooting the box. The last two, those that are in black text, those are being added in cumulative update 1. So one of them is a system bus reset event. We know from our experience when system bus resets happen, they're going to log event 129, and more often than not, some, if not all, of the storage stack is going to be hung out to lunch and waiting for someone to hit the power button. So now we don't even wait for anything to happen. As soon as we see that system bus reset event, as soon as event 129 is logged, boom, we will go ahead and recover from that by, once again, forcibly rebooting the box. And then the last behavior we added is monitoring the local replication endpoints. We try to communicate with the replication service endpoints locally, and if it doesn't work, we raise a flag into the Crimson Channel, thereby causing Active Manager to once again, terminate WinInit and bug check the box. All right. Now let's talk about some of the lag copy challenges. Just out of curiosity, how many of you are using lag copies today? All right, just a few of you. Okay. Well, some of the challenges, for those of you who are using, you probably know that activation can be really difficult, especially if you're using it to recover from some form of logical corruption that might have gotten into the database that requires you to sever the log stream and not replay all the logs all the way up. But the other problem is lag copies require manual care. Okay, there's nothing automatic about lag copies. They are basically DR copies, not HA copies. And the other thing is, because a lag copy might not have all the database information in it, they also can't be they can't undergo a process called page patching, which is a feature we introduced in Exchange 2010 to self-heal a database that has page corruption in it. So for example, if you've ever encountered a JET negative 1018 or 1019 or 20, 21, or 22, any of those errors that indicate you've got page corruption in your database, the page patching mechanism in a database availability group was designed to self-heal the database and repair it so that you don't have to restore it from backup. But again, because a lag copy might not have that page yet, it can't be page patched. It requires that manual care. So the innovations that we have, there's two primary innovations we have around lag copies. The first is we've kind of given them the ability to care for themselves in some of these situations. So for instance, the page patching situation. When we detect that a lag copy is going to need to be page patched when it eventually plays the log file, then the lag copy is, if you enable this, will automatically start playing its logs forward to that point so that it has the bad page that can then be patched automatically by the process. So it does destroy slightly the lag nature of itself, but it does so that it can self-heal itself. Another way it can do that is in a low disk space condition. Obviously, again, lag copies have asymmetrical storage requirements. There's more log buildup on a lag copy than a normal passive copy, so you need to have more disk space to store all that. And if you get down to a low disk space condition, really you've got very low agility to get out of that. About the best that you could do was probably throw away the content index on that drive and maybe buy yourself some gigabytes of space that way. But now what we have is the ability for a lag copy to once again bring itself up to a date to a certain point until it's above the free disk space threshold that is established by the system. By default, it's 10%, but you can change that to whatever figure that you want. Then the third condition is to reestablish redundancy. So for example, when your lag copy might be your only other copy besides your active copy in a redundancy environment. So for instance, during a 24-hour period, but the 24 hours is configurable. If it turns out that your lag copy is needed to establish redundancy so that you have a viable passive copy that can be activated, once again, the lag copy can play down its log files and bring itself up to date. Now, of course, you need to enable these features. It's not going to destroy itself automatically, or self-heal itself, I should say, automatically. But we are still giving you the ability to have them care for themselves if you need to. But just be aware, of course, anytime it's playing down its lag files, that means the replay lag time that you've configured may not be the actual lag time of the database at that point in time. But now in terms of activation, the other thing that we've done is we've integrated lag copies with a transport feature called SafetyNet. And SafetyNet replaces the transport dumpster feature that we had in Exchange 2010 with one important difference. The transport dumpster in Exchange 2010 was not only limited by time, but it was also limited by size, which meant even if you weren't expired the time period, a very large message could come in and push a whole bunch of messages out, thereby potentially reducing your resiliency through that feature. So now we just have SafetyNet, and SafetyNet just has a time limit. And the beauty of SafetyNet is if you just want to bring a lag copy up to date, then you don't have to worry about replaying the log files. As long as your SafetyNet retention period is equal to or greater than your replay lag time, then all you need to do is mount the lag copy database as it is without replaying any log files, and it will identify itself as a recovered database and automatically request resubmission of all of the missing messages during that time period from the SafetyNet feature. So that means if you don't want to mess around with log storage anymore and you just want to bring the database up to date, you don't have to manually run ESUtil to activate that copy. It can just be mounted and it will grab the data back from SafetyNet. Now, of course, if it's a logical corruption issue, we still give you the ability to do the log surgery if you need to. And you can do that anyway if you want to for whatever recovery purpose you have. But now we have a new option that allows you to very quickly and easily mount a lag copy and then have all the missing data come back in from the SafetyNet feature. All right, so those were the innovations in storage. Let's peel the curtains back a little bit and take a look at some of the innovations that we have in the primary high availability areas of Exchange 2013. So some of the challenges that we have are around the fact that if you look at the high availability model that we have in Exchange 2010, namely things like what application or Active Manager does, rather, and around database availability group health, it's largely only focused on database copy and content index health. Okay, that's all we're really looking at when we're doing something like best copy selection in Exchange 2010. And there's also some management challenges that some customers have around DAG networks as well, particularly customers who've extended their DAGs to multiple subnets. They have to do this extra management task of collapsing their DAG networks. And if they don't do that extra step, even if they have a separate replication network configured, we will still only replicate over the MAPI network. And that can cause all sorts of problems or confusions for folks. So the innovations that we have, first, we have a whole new technology built in called managed availability, and it doesn't just run on the mailbox server, it also runs on the client access server. And second, we have enhanced and changed and further bolstered the best copy selection algorithm, and we've changed it so much, we actually call it now best copy and server selection instead. And I'll walk you through what I mean by that in a moment. And then the other change is we are automatically collapsing your DAG networks, and we are automatically configuring DAG networks for you out of the box. And I'll show you what I mean by that in a minute as well. But let's talk about managed availability first, because it, like I said, it is brand new technology, and it's based on this one key principle in Exchange 2013 that relates to a significant architectural change. And that key principle is this. Yes, we have a client access server, but that is a thin, lightweight protocol proxy. All of the real protocol code now runs on the mailbox server. So the legacy client access server code, which server role, which used to have this code, has actually been blended into the mailbox role in Exchange 2013. And the new role that we call client access server is different. It's just a lightweight, thin protocol proxy. So that means the protocols are on the mailbox server now. And what it also means is that access to a user's mailbox is always going to go through the protocol stack on the server that hosts the active copy of their mailbox. So wherever my mailbox is active, I'm being proxied through a CAS, but the real service is coming from the protocol stubs that are on the mailbox server themselves, which means a couple things. First of all, it means that if the protocol stubs on mailbox are down, it doesn't matter how healthy the databases are. I'm not getting into my database anymore. It also means another thing. It means that the model that we had for assessing best copy selection, which again only focused on replication health and didn't look at the protocols at all, that means that model is now insufficient for Exchange 2013 and had to get changed. So managed availability was designed to first change that model and give us an augmentation to best copy selection, and second, to give you basically monitoring and high availability with recovery-oriented features for the protocol level and, just so it happens, every other aspect of Exchange as well. So, what is managed availability? Well, it's an internal framework that was developed by the high availability component team, and then every other component team within Exchange, any engineering team that makes any piece of Exchange, for instance, the store team, the AD team, the networking team, the POP team, the ActiveSync team, the OWA team, every single component team has components that play into this managed availability framework. And as I mentioned, it's monitoring plus high availability plus automatic recovery. So just like we have for the DAG, managed availability is kind of looking at everything else and making sure that everything else is working fine. And if it's not, taking corrective action. And if that corrective action doesn't solve the problem, escalating to a human so that a human can get involved. So one of the forms of action it can take is now managed availability also has the potential of triggering database and server failovers. For example, as I just mentioned, all access to a database comes from the protocol stack on the mailbox server. So for instance, if the OWA stack is down, if Outlook Web App is not functioning, no one is getting into their database via Outlook Web App at that point. So at that point, because that would be a server-wide outage, managed availability might decide to recover service from that by triggering a server failover and moving the active copies of a database to where OWA is on a healthy server. But of course, it might be a problem just affecting an individual database. It could be maybe perhaps a poison message came in and crashed a database. And in that case, managed availability has the ability to fail over a single database as well. The other thing managed availability also includes now is that single copy alert we shipped in Exchange 2010, or what we call the database one copy alert schedule. If you're not familiar with that, look in the task scheduler on your Exchange 2010 mailbox servers, and you'll see what it is. It's basically a script that periodically runs in Exchange 2010 that was looking for databases that were in a replicated environment that were down to just one copy left. Okay? That's a very bad state to be in, particularly if you're in a JBOD environment, because if your one copy is on a non-rated disk and that disk fails, you've just lost all of your databases at that point. So the single copy alert we thought was so important, we actually shipped it out of band in between Exchange 2010 and Exchange 2010 SP1. But since then, we've moved away from using the script, and we've included all of the checks that it would do inside natively managed availability. So that means, first, you don't have to deal with the script, and second, the task scheduler service is no longer a requirement for you to install the mailbox server role as it is at Exchange 2010. All right, so as I mentioned earlier, one of the other things that managed availability changes is this best copy selection algorithm. So remember, best copy selection, if you're not running Exchange 2010, it's a process that the replication service, that Active Manager, uses to determine the best passive copy of a database to activate in response to either a failover or what we call a targetless switchover. A targetless switchover is when an administrator is doing a database switchover, but they don't specify the mailbox server to activate. They let Active Manager choose that best copy. Now, in Exchange 2010, when best copy selection runs, the algorithm is designed to look at four health criteria around the database. One is the copy queue length, one is the replay queue length, one is the database health, and the other is the content index health. Now, as I mentioned earlier, and I'm intentionally sounding like a broken record, all access to a database goes through that protocol stack on mailbox, which means just looking at database health, just looking at content index health, that's not good enough. We need to find out if the protocols are healthy before we do a database failover. Because if the database is fine but the protocols are down, failover could make things worse. Okay? We never want that to happen. So what we have now is what we call best copy and server selection. So in terms of the copy selection, it's still an Active Manager algorithm. It's still done at star overtime. So again, failovers and targetless switchovers. The replication health is still determined by those same four criteria. So we still look at the copy and replay queue length and database and content index health to determine whether or not we've got good databases. But now there's also looking at the various health of the components on the server as well. And in fact, we are not only examining servers that are potential candidates for activation, but we are also evaluating on the health of the server on which the failure occurred as well. And we have these new constraints that we impose into this best copy selection algorithm. And we do that so that we can guarantee that at no time failover will ever make anything worse. Failover, as you know, is usually designed to make things better. In some cases, as you'll see in a moment, it might make things the same, but in no way will failover ever make things worse. We have new constraints that take in all sorts of things into account. So, what do those constraints look like? So after we've verified replication health and we've got a list of the servers that have viable passive copies for us to activate, then we'll do the analysis and assess server health. And we'll do that by looking at the health as reported in what are called health sets from managed availability. So the way it works is the first thing we'll do is we'll look for a server whose health sets are in an all healthy state. And what that means is this server is the perfect candidate to fail over to. It's got a viable database copy, and everything about this server is green. It's got all healthy states on all the different aspects of every single component. Protocol, stores, all the services are running, there's no bad performance, everything is beautiful on this server. If we can't find a server that meets that requirements, then we'll look to one that we call up to normal healthy. Now, of course, we didn't have time to get into managed availability health sets, but check out the documentation. But real briefly, these health sets have priorities associated with it. Obviously, a health set around the Active Directory component is going to be a very high priority type health set. After all, if Active Directory has a problem when we can't communicate with it, Exchange is going to stop to function. So that has a very high priority. But some lightly used protocols like POP and IMAP, they have lower priorities for the health sets as well. So all health sets have like low, medium, normal, high, critical, and so forth. So we're looking at all the health sets that have a medium priority or higher that are in a healthy state. If we find a server that meets that criteria, that's the one that we'll choose for failover. If you can't find a server that meets that criteria, the next one is all better than source. Okay, so once again, this is something new that we're doing. We evaluate the health of the source, where that failure occurred. And we're looking for any other server that has a viable copy whose health sets, when compared with the source, are in a better state. And if we can't find that, then we'll simply look for a server whose health sets are in the same state on the server that failed, hoping that we might make things better by going over there. Again, we might not. Things might stay the same because the health sets are in the same state. However, we're going to try anyway, and maybe things will get better. But again, because of these criteria that we enforce and impose, we will never, ever make anything worse via failover, even with these new constraints. So much more sophisticated, much more thoughtful type of algorithm for the best copy and server selection process now. All right, so let's talk about DAG networks and some of the innovations that we made there. So I basically mentioned then, the first is that we'll automatically collapse your DAG networks for you, so now administrators don't have to take that extra step in a multi-subnet environment, which again, technically wasn't such a big deal. We had documentation on how to do that, and only took a couple seconds to do, literally, and it was a one-time operation. But now, no one has to do that, and we don't have to worry about handling that manually. The other thing that we do is, after we create the DAG networks for you, they're in kind of this read-only mode. So you can't see any information about them other than their names in the Exchange Administration Center, and you can't really do anything to manipulate them in the shell either. They're in this read-only mode. So let me show you what I mean by that. So this is the Exchange Administration Center here, and I've got my database availability group, and I have these two DAG networks. One is called MAPI DAG Network. The other one's called Replication DAG Network 01. Those are the standard naming conventions that we use out of the box by default. But as you can see, there's nothing really I can do under here. I can just read the names. I can't really modify anything about DAG networks at this point. So what I need to do is I need to click this Edit button to edit the properties of my DAG, and I need to go down here to this Configure Database Availability Group Networks Manually checkbox. And then I need to check that box. I need to click Save. And then when I do that, you can see now these links appear in Exchange Admin Center. So now I've got functionality at my fingertips where I could do something like click on, where did my mouse go? Click on View Details for the MAPI DAG Network. And now I can see all the details of the MAPI DAG Network, the name. I could change the subnets. I could disable replication, et cetera, et cetera. And here's the replication DAG network. I could also manipulate that one as well. So out of the box, the DAG networks are now sort of read-only, automatically configured for you by the DAG. If you need to make any changes to it, you need to enable manual control. I showed you how to do it in the GUI. There's also a way that you can use Set Database Availability Group and do that in the shell as well. But if you do need to manipulate DAG networks, you do have to turn on manual config in order to do that. Okay, so now let's pull the curtains behind some of the cyber resilience innovations that we've introduced. So once again, remind me, how many of you have DAGs that are extended to multiple sites for site resilience? Okay, just a few of you. How many of you are interested in doing that? All right, even more, even better. So for those of you who don't have DAGs that are extended to sites, this will be perhaps some new information for you. Those of you who do have DAGs extended for multiple sites, you know, for instance, that site resilience, quite frankly, is operationally complex in Exchange 2010. It is. It's very easy to set up the DAG. It's very easy to extend the DAG to multiple sites. But when you have to do what we call a data center switchover, which involves recovering the DAG and your namespaces and potentially the other server roles and changing DNS and doing all these other things in response to some data center level event, you know that's a very operationally complex type of situation. And you also know that it's a manual situation. It's completely human-driven. There's no concept of what we call a data center failover in Exchange 2010. And in fact, 2010 was never designed for data center failover, so you will never see data center failover capabilities in 2010. One of the other challenges with 2010 is that from a recovery and other standpoints, client access, e.g. the namespace, and recovery of the DAG, they're tied together. Okay, that's a huge challenge, and I'll talk you through what I mean by that in a moment. But basically, you cannot recover one without the other. But perhaps the biggest challenge that we have in the Exchange 2010 site resilience paradigm is the namespace. You know, the URL that you give to users so that they know how to get their mail. That is a single point of failure. Okay, that is a huge, huge challenge in the Exchange 2010 paradigm. So what is really interesting about all of the innovations that we've done in Exchange 2013 is that literally all the innovations turn all of these challenges into the exact opposite. So what do I mean by that? I mean that site resilience is operationally simplified. Okay, super simplified, so much so that in some cases you will get data center failovers and you won't have to have administrator intervention depending on your configuration. And as a result of the architectural changes, CAS and mailbox have been completely decoupled from another, from many aspects as well, including from a recovery aspect. You don't have to recover one just because you lost the other and vice versa. But perhaps the biggest innovation, the best thing that we've done so far, is around the namespace. It was a single point of failure in Exchange 2010, but in Exchange 2013, using the model that we have today, the namespace provides redundancy. Okay, it's the exact opposite of 2010. So you have to understand just a few key characteristics of the new model. The first characteristic is that we're using round-robin DNS. Okay, that's one of the elements of this solution. And that's nothing fancier than multiple A records in DNS pointing to different IP addresses. I'll show you some examples in a moment. The other characteristics is, and we haven't talked about it in this session, but that the majority of client access is now HTTP-based. Okay, so we've got Outlook Web App, we have ActiveSync, we have Exchange Web Services, we have the new Exchange Administration Center, which is the web-based UI, we have Remote PowerShell, and guess what? All access via Outlook is also now only HTTP-based. Okay, that's an important thing we haven't had time to talk about, and that is a Outlook client connectivity model change. We no longer allow Outlook to connect to Exchange 2013 via RPC over TCP. Of course, we're still using MAPI, we're just not doing it over straight TCP. We now only allow Outlook connectivity via RPC over HTTP, or what we call Outlook Anywhere. Okay, so what that means is, again, the majority of clients are HTTP-based. And guess what? When you use round robin with HTTP clients, they have the ability to automatically fail over themselves. And they'll do so within 20 seconds when that client encounters what we call a hard failure, or basically the inability to establish a TCP session. And of course, the admin can always go into DNS and remove failed VIPs from there. And we'll talk about when you might want to do that in a moment as well. But what that means, though, is now the namespace has redundancy. It's no longer a single point of failure. But more importantly, especially those of you who have gone through a data center switchover, what it also means is that because you get failover capabilities now, you don't have to go and change DNS, which means no dealing with DNS latency, which sure, here in Holland isn't a big deal. But in some parts of the world, it's an extremely big deal. In some parts of the world, it could take, in some cases, days for DNS records to replicate around the environment. But now you don't have to deal with DNS latency. So let me describe what I mean previously by decoupling things. Okay, so for instance, previously, if you lost a majority of your CAS servers, or you lost your CAS array, or you lose the load balancer in front of the CAS array, or you lose the top of rack, or you lose a switch, or you lose all your DAG members, or so many DAG members that you can no longer provide the same level of service that you wanted to, you had to do a data center switchover. In response to losing one of these critical elements, you had to move everything over to the other data center. And that was an operationally complex type of thing. And it took, in some cases, hours to complete. And all that time, service and data access is offline. But in Exchange 2013, depending on your configuration, recovery can happen automatically, which means instead of the admin doing a data center switchover, that happens automatically in a data center failover session, and now the admin is simply working on restoring whatever piece of equipment failed that is currently no longer affecting service because service recovered itself. Any admin will tell you that the stress they'll be under during a data center switchover is quite intense, but the stress of an admin replacing a failed component that is not affecting anything is non-existent. Previously, CAS and mailbox were tied together from a recovery standpoint. They no longer are, which means they can fail, but now the failures and recovery mechanisms are independent. And in some cases, depending on your configuration, may come in the form of automatic failover again. And now, the most important thing, with the namespace simplification, the consolidation of server roles, the separation of CAS array from a recovery and AD standpoint, with the decoupling of them, with the load balancing changes, that means with all of these underlying changes that we made in Exchange 2013, we're allowed and we are giving you the ability now with a three-site configuration to get automatic failover for the DAG in response to some sort of data center level event. Okay, now what does that mean? Obviously you have to have three locations, but I want to be clear, we are not telling anybody to go out and get a third location to do this. This is really only going to be an option economical enough for customers that already have more than two locations. Okay, so obviously two of the locations are going to have your Exchange servers, and they need to be very well connected, just like any extended DAG would need to be. And this third location, that would be where your witness server exists, and that simply needs to be isolated from network failures that are affecting the other two locations. And in doing that, in getting this configuration, once again, you can achieve a data center failover, as I'll show you in a moment here. But I do want to stress one very important thing. This is Exchange 2013 only. All of these underlying changes and other significant architectural changes had to be made in order to make this a reality. Okay? You can only do this in 2013. You cannot do this in 2010. If you're wondering why you can't do this in 2010, go and read an old blog article I wrote called Exchange High Availability Misconceptions that will explain very clearly why you cannot have this model in Exchange 2010. This is Exchange 2013 paradigm only. The Exchange 2010 and earlier paradigm is over, and a new paradigm is beginning with Exchange 2013. So, let's talk about some of these behaviors and some of these automatic failovers that you get. Let's start by looking at the CAS array. So I've got two different Active Directory sites here, one in Redmond, one in Portland. Each of them has two servers in a CAS array, and above them they each have a load balancer, and each of the load balancer has a unique virtual IP address associated with it, 192.168 and 10.0 over here. In DNS, I have two A records for mail.contoso.com, which is the namespace that I'm using. One that points to the 192 address, one that points to the 10.0 address. As a result of this configuration, during normal operations, thanks to round robin DNS, half of my clients will be connecting to VIP1, the other half will be connecting to VIP2 at any given time. If something catastrophic happens and we lose one of the VIPs, clients already have the other IP address, and as soon as they can no longer make a TCP connection to the failed IP address, they will wait 20 seconds and then automatically try the next address in there. So now this is where the admin decides whether or not they want to take that other failed address out of DNS. So if the 192 address, if it's just a small hiccup, and it's only going to be down for a very short amount of time, don't mess with DNS, because again, that change will have to replicate, and you may need to deal with DNS latency. Besides, it doesn't matter if we're sending half the people to a dead door. It's only going to be a 20-second wait for them to fail over to the good door. Okay, if it's going to be a lengthy outage, maybe this data center at Redmond is now a smoking hole and it's not coming back, then you want to go out and take that out of DNS because there's no point in sending people there anymore. Okay, so that is one significant difference that we have now. Now let's look at the back end and see what the DAG looks like. First, looking at the third site configuration. Again, this is not going to be an option for all customers, but if you can take advantage of this option, then you certainly have some benefits here. Once again, I've got the same two sites, Redmond and Portland, and I have my DAG members extended between them. And because I have an even number of DAG members, I'm using a witness server, and in this case, I put my witness server in Paris. And I actually do that for a very specific reason. Portland and Redmond, as you probably know, are in North America, and Paris, obviously, is in Europe. And that's a trick that we do in the service. We always keep our witness server in a different geographic region from the other DAG members. And we do that intentionally. If you've ever seen that map of the way the internet's actually connected, all those fiber channel pipes that are in the bottom of the ocean floor that actually connects the world together via the internet, well, there are some geographic regions, like in Asia, for example, that are just connected by one pipe. Okay, so if that pipe gets severed, it could take out Australia, New Zealand, Hong Kong, Singapore, and other geographic regions. So remember the three site criteria: that witness server site has to be isolated from network failures that can affect the other two sites. So we do that on a geographic basis. So that way, if something happens to one of the North American sites, there's no way it's going to affect the witness server. If something happens to the witness site, there's no way it's going to affect any of the North American sites. The other reason I chose Paris is I like to visit my witness server for 2 weeks in the summer. So I put it there. Okay, so what happens? Same sort of failure mode. We lose our primary data center, or we lose the DAG members in the primary data center. But because that the other two sites are unaffected, the backup site and our witness server site, as long as they continue to have network connectivity, one of those DAG members will reach out, lock the witness server, maintain quorum, keep the solution up and running, and give you a data center failover for your database availability group. Okay, so great news for those of you who have three locations to do this. But again, don't go and get a third location to do this. It is not economically justified. We will have time for questions, I promise. And we're actually almost done, too. I want to show you the two-site configuration, though, because I imagine many of you only have two locations, and you want to see how the behavior is better. Well, the good news is the behavior is significantly better for you as well. Things have been operationally simplified for you as well. You don't have to do a full data center switchover anymore. So again, similar scenario. I've got my DAG extended between the two sites, except in this case, I'm following the two-site model, which is I have my witness server in my primary data center, so that has the majority of votes. But once again, if I lose my primary data center, then that's going to cause an outage. Both servers should have failed. There we go. Okay, that's going to cause an outage. Okay, so obviously it's causing an outage in the Portland data center because that's just two remaining servers, and they lose quorum and they terminate. So what that means is now the administrator has to recover service, but you don't have to do a full data center switchover anymore. All you need to do is these three commands. That's all you need to do to restore service to the DAG. One is running stop DAG to mark the Redmond site as failed. The other is running stop cluster service, so you can stop them in preparation for running the third command, which is restore DAG, which will automatically evict the failed servers, invoke the alternate witness server, thereby giving you a majority of votes, and thereby maintaining quorum and allowing databases to mount again. So it's just one, two, three quick steps. It'll just take you a few seconds to do that. And in fact, you'll probably script it and just hit a big red button when things go bad. All right. So in summary, we have a lot of storage innovations in there that are giving you hardware efficiencies, including by optimizing for hardware that doesn't even exist yet. They'll reduce costs. They'll increase your reliability and availability. We have high availability innovations that extend high availability and monitoring now into the protocol stack so that we can evaluate the total health of the system and focus not on individual components, but on the overall end user experience. And we have site resilience innovations that make things so much more operationally simplified, provide you with data center failover capabilities, and provide you with native namespace redundancy. That's one of my favorite new ones. What's even better is when you watch that in reverse. Yeah, I love that. I probably spend too much time watching that go back and forth. Okay, all right. So as I said, we'll have time for questions. In fact, it looks like we have a fair amount of time left for questions. But of course, if you don't have any questions today, here's my contact info. Feel free to send me email and ask me any questions about anything we talked about today or anything about Exchange 2013 that you might want to know. So with that, I know a few of you had questions, so just go ahead and raise your hand and we'll get to you one by one. Yes?
Can the witness server be on Windows Azure?
That is not only an excellent question, but almost always the very first question I get after this session. So congratulations on that. I did not set that up. Unfortunately, the answer is no. We don't test Azure, so Azure is not supported to use the witness server. So that is a very clever way to try and get that third location, but it's not tested, and so it's not supported. The other thing is, there may be scenarios in which using Azure specifically and only for witness server functionality may not be the most cost-effective way to get your witness server. It's really all going to come down to what your business requirements are. And if your business requirements really require that service level objective that says we have to have data center failover, then that economically might mean that it could justify some sort of rent a location, if you will.
I have another one.
Yes. Can you put the witness server, on a domain controller? It is. We wouldn't recommend it. Because when you are using a non-Exchange server as the witness server, you have to take a universal security group called the Exchange Trusted Subsystem, and you have to add it to the local admins group on the server. But since it's a domain controller, there is no local admins group, so you're basically taking the Exchange security group and turning it into a domain admin, which is turning all of your Exchange servers into domain admins, and of course any administrator with access to that into a domain admin as well. But of course it's fully supported because there's some customers who that is simply the only other servers that they have. They have Exchange and nothing else but directory servers, and so we absolutely do support that, but that would not be the first place you choose for your witness server. Yes?
You mentioned
Sure. So the question was, I was talking about how the best copy and server selection algorithm has been enhanced through managed availability by our evaluation of its health sets, in part through that constraint criteria that talks through the priorities that health sets have. So unfortunately, you cannot change the priority of a health set. That is hard-coded today. You do have the ability to set some overrides on managed availability, but none that would directly affect the best copy and server selection process. So you can, for instance, override some of the thresholds it uses before it will take recovery action, which, you know, in a production environment, you might not need to do. But if you're in a resource-constrained lab environment, you probably absolutely would want to do. But right now, we don't give you the ability to change the priority of health sets because we expect them to be the priorities that they are fixed at by the component teams. So it's each individual component team gets to set its own health set priority. And so that isn't to say, I didn't mean to call out POP specifically as being like a low priority protocol. It's just as an example versus other critical dependencies. In other words, if POP fails, it's only affecting the POP users, versus if Active Directory fails, everything tips over. Okay. What else you got? So everybody's fully mastered managed availability then. Yes, yes. Sure. So if you couldn't hear the comment, and I'm going to sort of summarize it, the comment was basically that I hear that SSD drives from a storage vendor, I hear that SSD drives are coming out, they're going to be faster, they're going to replace SATA and SAS disks, and they'll give you more in-memory computing versus a spinning platter type of storage mechanism. So yeah, SSD drives are out now. We do support SSD storage for Exchange. Quite frankly, though, it's a little uninteresting from an Exchange perspective because of its cost per gigabyte. Now, original SSD drives were very uninteresting for us because they had reliability issues. But today's drives are much more reliable, and so they could be used as things like secondary cache on a controller. But because of their cost per gigabyte, if you start using those types of drives, you're really driving up the cost of the system, especially when you consider these very large data sets we're going to be dealing with, and especially when you consider the fact that you're going to want multiple copies for redundancy. So I'm sure the storage vendors would love to sell you that super expensive storage, but from an Exchange perspective, our whole mantra is keeping the cost of the solution down. Yeah, so that, you know, that's one opinion perhaps. Our feeling is that we've specifically optimized for low-cost SATA and SAS drives, these larger 8 terabyte drives that will be out shortly, and that is what we've optimized. That is what we believe that will be the most economical and best solution for customers to deploy on. If customers do decide to go the SSD route, sure, that's their choice. Customers are free to buy and use any supported storage for Exchange that they want. So if they feel like they're getting a better experience and they're happy to, in some cases, pay more or maybe not, depending on what happens, then that would be fine. You know, as long as it is supported storage for Exchange, we're good to go. Our feeling, though, is that, you know, we've targeted this storage so that we can drive greater adoption of JBOD because it is the lowest cost and simplest way to support an Exchange infrastructure, especially after you get to a certain scale. So, but yeah, great question. Anything else? So all you guys are going to run and do single worldwide namespace now, and automatic data center failover now, and yep. All right. Well, okay. Well, if there's no further questions, thanks very much for coming. Hope you enjoy the rest of Tech Days. And like I said, don't be shy. Feel free to contact me if you have any other questions. Take care.